It gives me immense pleasure to invite Dr. Nandita Pal Shetkar to give her star talk on messy disease with poor outcome, endometriosis, a terror for all of us.
Hi, good morning, everybody. It's a real pleasure to be here today. And first of all, I want to congratulate Manjushri and the entire team. We must give them applause. I think it's infertility is something that is very, troubling. It's a social disease also, not only a medical disease. And there are lots of changes. You know, today my topic, this is something very close to my heart, endometriosis. I treat a lot of patients and I keep updated with what is happening. And there is a complete change in the treatment of endometriosis. You know, when I began my practice 28 years ago, it used to be surgery first. But there has been a change because there are a lot of new things which have come up and we need to keep abreast with what is required for the patient. I think it's very, very important and all of us see endometriosis patients and we need to realize how we should treat them. So 1 in 10 women in reproductive age group definitely has endometriosis. And if you look at infertility, you know, it affects everything. The ovulation, the immunological, the peritoneal. What we always forget is the endometrial dysfunction. It affects also the endometrium. So when you're trying to get her pregnant, we need to clean up the endometrium. So yes, when you're doing it naturally, there's no choice except surgery. But otherwise, what you can do in an IVF is give a GnRH analog or give a progesterone, which will clear the disease in the endometrium. And definitely your results will be much, much better. Treatment plan, you just divide your patients into three groups, you know, adolescent, infertile, and recurrent endometrioma. And that's how you need to remember how to treat them. So what are the medical, what are the options that are available? You can give medical therapy to the patient, you can do surgery, you can do IVF, ET, or even egg donation sometimes in certain patients where the damage is irreparable. So if you look at surgery, we've been taught from a long time that we need to do surgery for our patients. Surgery is the first line of options. So let me put a caveat here. Here it's important that you do the serum AMH. Trust me, people may be telling you AMH is not proper, it may not be good, this, that, but I think it's very important to do that report because it will tell you what is the damage occurred due to the disease of endometriosis. And that will actually guide you whether to do surgical treatment or medical treatment. Because remember, surgery by itself can damage the AMH, you know, especially the endometrioma surgery where you go in and operate on the ovary. So you have to balance the two things out. But remember, there are advantages also to the surgery. If the girl is young, if her reserve is good, then she has a chance of a natural pregnancy after treating the disease. So that's why the AMH is important. If her reserve is good, if her age is good, you can do the surgery and wait for 6 months to 1 year. Though ESHRE ASRM guidelines all say that do IUI. It doubles your pregnancy rate. But remember, the AMH, the ovarian reserve, will actually guide you what treatment this patient needs. Cystectomy, definitely cystectomy is the way to go. And it is a good treatment because the recurrence rates are very low as 5 to 10%. The only thing is, how does the cystectomy affect your ovarian reserve? So please, please do an AMH before you do the cystectomy. And then maybe 3 to 6 months later after the cystectomy. So the endometrioma dimension, if it's a larger endometrioma, more damage and your cystectomy will cause lower AMH. And the use of preoperative suppressive therapy and perhaps surgeon experience. The word perhaps is used in this September issue last year, 2019. But I feel it definitely depends on the surgeon experience. Endometriosis is to be operated by specialists, by those who are very good at it, so that they don't undermine the ovary, they don't damage the ovary, and you respect the ovary. That is what is really important. So how will you decrease the injury? Minimal use of electrosurgery, any kind of energy. Laser is of course recommended to be the best, but it's not available everywhere. So electrosurgery should be minimal. Precise hemostasis and use of alternative methods to electrosurgery. Like what we do is we just give mechanical pressure. You know, you've done the cystectomy, if the bed is bleeding, just give mechanical pressure for 2 to 3 minutes and see. Or you put a suture, because that way you don't damage the surrounding tissue. Unilateral versus bilateral, there's a lot of debate going on. In fact, this meta-analysis of 783 women came out, which actually said that the drop in AMH in the unilateral group was only 40%, whereas if it was bilateral, it was as high as 60%. So we really need to think twice before doing unilateral. Maybe this patient would benefit, you know, from medical therapy, and if her tubes are open, maybe an IUI or an IVF. So ASRM and ESHRAE have recognized, this is only pre-IVF, so you don't mix up the issues. You need to understand that if you're going in for IVF in an endometriosis patient, then when do you require surgery? Only if there's severe pelvic pain, that means this patient is symptomatic, or the endometrioma is too big, it's not allowing the follicles to grow, or access to the ovary is impaired because of the big endometrioma. So these are the only conditions where if you're going for IVF, you need to do a primary surgery. But if your patient is young, AMH is good, I think primary surgery would probably benefit with no other, you know, comorbidities like a male factor or something like that. Medical treatment, I've finished with surgery, let's go to medical. Medical ideally should be one which cures the disease. But today we don't have anything that cures the disease because we don't know what is the cause of the disease. Samson's theory is what I read in my MBBS and all. But today we're talking about dysregulation of cytokines, or it could be an inflammatory, inflammatory process which leads to endometriosis. It could be an epigenetic process where the genes are activated. So all these things, we are really not sure what is the disease, and that's why probably we cannot find an ideal medication which will cure the disease. So whatever medications we have today are symptomatic. So we have elagolix, which has just been approved by the US FDA, capricoline, dinogest, MPA, LNGIUS, mifepristone. All these are various. I'm going to just talk about dinogest in the next slide. So a lot of us see these young patients, adolescent endometrioma. What I like to do in the young child, a 15, 16 year old with a small endometrioma, is put her on OC pills or put her on progesterone, dinogest. I think this works wonderful. The medical treatment is the treatment of choice in these girls. But yes, if the endometrioma is really large, you know, 5 centimeters, 8 centimeters, still if there's no pain, I would just, you know, manage it conservatively. But yes, if it's very large, then what we need to do is do this technique, which is a dual technique, which means a cystectomy, and near the hilus when you reach, you just fulgurate it, because there are a lot of follicles near the hilus, and if you do a cystectomy and then try hemostasis, you damage a lot. So Donaez has actually published this, I think, in 2010, where he actually said that if you do this combined technique, you'll cause less damage. Now, AMH is decreased in bilateral endometrioma, cyst size more than 7 centimeters, coagulation or suturing should be, suturing is better. So that is what we must remember when we are treating patients with adolescent endometriosis. I think the slides didn't get hidden only. Anyway, oocyte cryopreservation is something that you must offer adolescent patients. You know, I've had a patient who had one surgery when she was something like 17 or 18, the second surgery at 27, and she came to me at 30 again saying, I want to preserve eggs, and her AMH is 0.8. I've managed to get out something like 6 eggs, preserve them. She's coming for a second cycle. So I think from that we learn a lesson that you can't tell a girl today, go get married, your ovaries will die out. So you need to offer her something out of the box, and oocyte cryopreservation is that something which is here to stay. And I think we should offer our patients oocyte cryopreservation so that they can offer it to their patients rather than have a damage and then go for egg donation. Dinogest, a fantastic drug, hypoestrogenic, hyperprogestogenic, and also anti-proliferative, anti-inflammatory, and anti-angiogenic. All the effects that will suppress endometriosis. And it is a very good drug, 2 milligrams once daily. The side effect that I have seen is irregular bleeding. So we have to talk to the patients and counsel them about it, that, you know, don't worry, this, that. But if it really spoils the quality of life, what I do is I make it 2 BD. Okay, but otherwise, generally, I don't stop it, I think. And I've had more than 5 years experience of putting people continuously on Dinogest, and they've, you know, had no problems. You have to check the bone marrow, BMD also, because in the long run, that can get affected. Now, reproductive age group. There is this endometriosis fertility index. It's a fantastic index, but of course, it works well if you've done surgery, because the AFS, that's the American Fertility Score, is really, really important. But remember that if your endometriotic fertility index is very low, there's a 0% spontaneous chance of pregnancy. So as I told you before, surgery should be done in patients who are young and who have got a good ovarian reserve. So that time, chart her fertility index. If it's good, spontaneous pregnancy rate within 1 year of surgery is as high as 50%, and 5 years it's 91%. But of course, you're not going to wait because of the recurrence of the disease. But it's worth giving her a try. And if she doesn't conceive, then you can, of course, IVF is the treatment for patients with endometriosis, and you must think of it earlier rather than later. And grade 1, grade 2 endometriosis, IUI works. If your anatomical tubo ovarian anatomy is intact, it works. It really works very well. The only practical tip is use letrozole. And if you need to use any antagonist, is a good drug because it reduces the E2 level. So the recurrence rate, the cumulative endometriosis recurrence rate, the CERR, is much lower when you use this protocol. Ovarian endometrioma, surgery versus ART, as I said before, young patient, good AMH, surgery. But if you're going for IVF due to any other cause, or it's a grade 3, grade 4 endometriosis, then if an AMH is low and it's a huge endometrioma, you may go for surgery, because both the treatments have shown equally good results and it's not improved. So if IVF is necessary, then you can bypass the surgery. ASRM and Eshriya, as I said, the only indication for surgery before IVF is if she's symptomatic and if access to follicles is not easy, or the endometrioma is too large and it suppresses the ovary. So once you've decided what line of treatment you want to do, then you can add the surgical part to it. So in IVF, what precautions do you take? What I use at my unit at, in all the Bloom IVF and Leelavati is antagonist protocol with freezing. Because I want you to take you back to my first slide where endometriosis affects the endometrium. So what I do is I freeze all the embryos. I do pooling in those patients who have less number of eggs or the AMH is very, very low. And then give 1 to 2 cycles of GnRH analog. And then do a frozen thoiety. It gives you wonderful results. Trust me, even with one embryo in a young patient, we've had pregnancies. So age is quality of a patient. So don't waste too much time. Surgery, I would do first. And then if she doesn't conceive quickly within 6 months, I would rather switch to IVF. Then, you know, allow her ovarian reserve to go down, because the results are fantastic with her own genetic material. And every girl wants her own child, trust me. They are not easily, turned towards egg donation. In fact, let me tell you, does the surgeon matter? This is a fantastic work by Muzi. I've been following his work for the past 2 decades. He's a histopathologist who studies the specimens of the cysts once the cystectomy is done. And what he said is that experience and expertise is very, very important, because that causes the least damage to the ovary. And I think this is very, very important, especially when you're young and you want to start off. I think you should learn. There is a learning curve until you become an expert. endometriosis should be taken care of by an expert. Before going to deep endometriosis, I would like to talk about this one patient of mine. She was just 28 or 29 years old. She came to me and endometriosis. I've done multiple transfers in her. She had adenomyosis of the uterus and, you know, she had had multiple surgeries. 1122 eggs we were removing and she just has not got pregnant. And then she came to at a point where she said, we had to remove everything. We tried everything. So I even got Elagolix from abroad to treat her. But the pain and the quality of life was so bad that it was horrendous. So what we did was we frozen her ovary and kept it. When we did the THBSO, we frozen her ovary. So, you know, now there are many things that can happen. You can create a 3D scaffolding and put those follicles over there. You can even freeze her eggs before doing a THBSO so that she can have a child through surrogacy. So remember, friends, in endometriosis, you may think it's a simple thing, but you need the help of an ART specialist. You must think out of the box how you can help her have her own child. Okay. And pregnancy and endometriosis, I think that's very important. This was a beautiful study in 2017 by the ASRM, 24 studies, and can you believe how many women, 19 lakh women were in the study. And what happened? The preterm birth, the miscarriage rate, placenta previa, SGA and cesarean delivery all increased if the patient had endometriosis. So we really need to, if your patient conceives with endometriosis, look out for these and treat it as a high-risk pregnancy. Take care of her. You know, give her steroids. There's no harm. Use MaxSelf if she's going into preterm labor. Placenta previa, watch for it. You know, miscarriages really work. It works wonders if you give GnRH before she conceived. But if she's conceived, you just have to watch out for it. And I think that is very important for us to remember when we've got a patient of endometriosis pregnant. So I would like to end my talk by just concluding endometrioma. Operating technique has to be superb. You give long-term oral contraception in adolescent patients so that recurrence doesn't occur. In vitro fertilization and oocyte cryopreservation, they should be liberally offered. You have to open up your mind and offer this to the patients. And I'd like to conclude by saying different things matter. You know, the patient's age, the degree of damage by doing your AMH. If there's a deep infiltrating endometriosis, treat it before IVF because it gives better results. Presence or absence of ovarian failure and other factors associated with subfertility, male fertility. So optimal care of patients should be multidisciplinary and personalized. So thank you very much. I think you've been a wonderful audience listening so attentively. But really, this is something very close to my heart. And anytime any of you have questions, I'm ready to answer it. Thank you.
Dr. Nandita, these days, as you mentioned, the adolescence, it is a dilemma.
Yeah.
Say a 22, 23-year-old girl, unmarried, not sexually active, no pain, but you can some amount of dysmenorrhea comes with for dysmenorrhea. You see on ultrasound there is endometrioma.
How big? You know, I feel if her quality of life is not getting affected,
yeah,
I would put her on oral contraceptives or Dynogest.
Would you do a oocyte preservation? Say it's 5 centimeters.
Do her AMH.
Okay.
If the AMH is less than 2, I would actively promote oocyte preservation.
Even in a non-sexually
even
active
in
woman?
Even in a non-sexually active woman, yeah, that's the indication.
Okay. So and I had a second question.
Yeah.
Say asymptomatic, low AMH, but a big cyst. In fact, I have currently a lady like that, 34-year-old, AMH of 0.7. She has a 10 centimeter cyst. Asymptomatic.
See, when there is a woman of 34 years with the AMH of 0.7, I would definitely go for IVF, where I would go for collection of eggs. And a 10 centimeter cyst would really bother me in my pickup. So I do a little out of the way treatment. Maybe I just drain that cyst But ideally, it should be a cystectomy. But again, 0.7 means it becomes really, really bad. There, I didn't put that because it's controversial, but draining of the cyst with an ultrasound is also being done. Mm-hmm. And you can put, sclerosing agents. And though we don't have too much data on it, but it does say that the sclerosing agents do not reduce the AMH levels.
What do you use for sclerosing agents?
Alcohol, ethanol alcohol. So I've not done too many, I've done very few, but yeah, this is a tricky patient where
often
you get, the best surgeon to come and operate on you, on her, and maybe just, I would just put in a drain, drain the endometrioma, do multiple pickups because she will need two or three pickups to get those eggs out with 0.7. And
would we be able to stimulate her with that cyst sitting there?
Sandwich therapy. My son wants me to do sandwich therapy. Yeah, that's also an option. Yeah, actually, that's an option also. You can give GnRH analog. But you need the eggs out quickly.
But are you able to stimulate these patients?
Of course.
Okay.
But without surgery, I would try one cycle of stimulation. If the ovary is responding well, I'm getting number of eggs, I would wait. I would just get the eggs out. Okay. And then do the surgery probably before putting her in. Because you can have even rupture of the endometrioma during pregnancy. And 10 centimeters is big.
Yeah.
So it's a very different, it's individualized. Each patient is different.
Thank you so much.
But 0.7 is a warning signal. Go collect the eggs.
Okay, I'll do that. She's an anesthetist, in fact, the patient herself.
No, you should collect her eggs. And there are a lot of patients who say, Madam, I'm just 29. What are you telling me, IVF?
Yeah.
So I collect the eggs, I prepare the embryos, freeze them. I say, don't conceive if you don't want with IVF. But keep it as an insurance policy. Keep them. And then we'll try and make you conceive with surgery, after surgery, if she conceives spontaneously. But if she doesn't, I have her genetic material which is frozen. And a lot of patients who don't want it, by the end of two pickups, they are ready for ET also. So it's all very, I think it's very important to combine both the arms of the treatment. That is something that you must take home today. That in an endometrioma patient, it's important to work together with IVF so that you can give this lady a child which is her own genetic material.
Thank
and
you
with
so
genetic
much.
Therapy coming, it may,
Any
we
questions?
May find some different treatment for it.
Yeah. First surgery should be the last surgery.
Yes.
That is very important.
Yes.
So I think that from the best surgeon. I think that's the most important thing.
Any further questions? I think this is a very important topic, which actually most of us are afraid of. We have such a fantastic opportunity. Any questions, please? Wow, Dr. Nandita, you've
done a
fantastic
very clear,
job. No questions.
But thank you, Manju. Thank you so much
for
this opportunity to talk about something which I love.